каждый год 15.
Every year I remember that Michael Jackson came on September 15th. Michael Jackson is very famous in our country, though not very popular. Giving your love to people is no crime. For me, he was a soldier of goodness. A superhero, Mickey Mouse, Coca-Cola, he's everything that stands for a high-quality brand. Being Jackson can't be learned, for he's unique.
Everybody who knows what's up in this town is going to be there at Michael Jackson on Tuesday night.
Moscow 93 was a strange, gloomy place, with absolutely no likeness to Moscow as we know it today. It was absolutely anarchic city. Trading was crazy, with prices changing several times a day. Mud and dirt all around, complete lack of responsibility, disorder and imperceptibility. As I can recall, that Moscow was full of street markets, and former engineers went selling stuff in kiosks or making showbiz. I mean, it was the time of change. Nobody really knew what was coming. Everyone tried to buy or sell something, but those times were rather hard and sometimes hungry. There was an abyss between the Soviet-shaped people and the very rich traders. People did not know where to go, back to the Soviet era or forward to the unexplored, quite scary and somehow not understandable values of capitalism. In 93, we were extremely successful as business people and had a lot of money. We had been selling alcohol, which at that time was under weak control by the government, and the revenues were fantastic. When starting a business in 93, one knew that if you had enemies, you knew how far they would go to the very end. So you knew in advance that it would be a very sad end, and you would simply not survive till that concert. It was quite a tough time then, and even more than that. TV news reported that some people you met the day before were no longer alive. Moscow, 1993. It was a total mess all around. Gangsters, killings, shooting. And nobody knows how to install democracy. And I took over this concert of Michael Jackson when this proposal came. And I made it. This is it. So this mud and dirt, these regular bandit clashes, several contract killings a day, and this background did not go well with the image of an extraterrestrial, of a man from a completely different dimension, who was to come with the best show in the world. Where to? Right down here, to this kind of beauty.
Hello, Michael. He's in the perfect place there, Michael.
For a concert of that scale, it was quite strange to make such a huge concert without what is called a local promoter. And that was the last concert of that kind. Yep. As I remember, I came to the promoter's office to collect my press card, and I was amazed with the kind of home-like atmosphere that was there. I liked it very much, as I saw that the promoters were the same kind of non-pros, like the kind of journalist I was myself. Nevertheless, there was enthusiasm. I enjoyed to see it, and I instantly sympathized with the promoters. That's true. This is my rare press card. Here, I was 23 years old then. It was a very special approach to work, and a special level of requirements. And even the writer that was more or less translated into Russian, we read it, but we didn't understand it. And why did Michael Jackson's producer conclude the writer saying, "So help you God"? That was really terrific. The writer was around 600 pages, really thick. Even our translators failed to translate some words. For instance, aerospace. We had 20 translators, but no one knew what it was. Finally, we guessed that aerospace was simply an air heater. Despite that autumn weather in Moscow, muddy and windy, at the spot where we stood near the stage, it was incredibly hot, completely unexplainable, and people felt bad, really. In that rain, some people warmed up themselves, and many even danced, and there was a truly surrealistic picture. It looked like a soup being cooked out of people. I mean, a huge number of human heads and steam rising up. When Michael Jackson performed, it was quite cold, and heaters were put up for him not to freeze. On the day of the show, it was pretty clear that the rain was not going to stop, and the stage was going to be flooded. So I was given a suitcase full of cash and was told to go out and solve this problem. This has to be done. We don't know how, but go out and do it. It was raining, and the clouds had not been dispersed. Apparently, in 1993, that technique had not yet reached that level. The stage was wet, but I guess it had to be dry. That's why from time to time some cleaning ladies appeared. They were typical babushkas with coats and crumpled thick stockings, and wiped the stage with some kind of mops. It was really very funny. The rain flooded the stage, and those who wiped the stage with towels were Michael's tour managers, quite well-paid characters, and everyone knew them by name. Very serious and respected people, and they had to crawl wiping the stage. No one expected conditions like that, and it was really cold. And Michael, when he was doing what he had to do for the show, managed to maneuver between them. He was smiling every time, as if he was saying, "Guys, we are all in the same boat." I think this concert of Michael Jackson in Moscow was a kind of standalone, absolutely surrealistic event. And the strangest thing was that our people from Moscow and Russia did not have a thing to do with the organization of that concert. The supervisor from our department was an Englishman, and the team for the stage props was English as well.
There are nine people from England, and the others are local It's a local crew composed, I'm not sure of how many people.
Foreigners who climb up to the high perch do not work more than 45 minutes. After that, they come down and say it's coffee time. So we had to make coffee and sandwiches for them. At the beginning, our people did not want to do it, because to climb up to 15 meters and 15 meters back down was quite tiring. But as they saw that there was food and coffee, they quickly got it. After 45 minutes of work, they had 15 minutes coffee break. This way, they worked 8 to 10 hours a day with coffee breaks. A real sweatshop it was. Several days before the concert, I had a hard time, with no sleep at all. So the first time ever, I learned what a deadline means when doing this job. The so-called Luzhniki Arena was broken down and ramshackled, but we had to put it in shipshape. This was defined by the rider and by the contract. There was no chance to breach it, for if we only breached just one point, the concert would not have taken place at all. As the show was to begin, nothing was sure yet. Michael spent more than 20 minutes in his private backstage room and did not come out. We understood that everything could be a flop, and the people that came to the stadium would feel cheated. But there was nothing we could do about it. No doubt, he had the right not to go on stage under such conditions. So when he appeared, I really felt tears of joy fill my eyes. And I couldn't help it because I had not slept for several days waiting for this moment. And a lot of effort had been put in to make this come true. And then everyone started shouting, "It's him, it's him." But I didn't see anything because people were standing in front of me. I tried to stand on my tiptoes. A friend of mine who came with me, an adult, quite a big fellow, he stared at me like a kindergarten girl. "We see it all. We see it all." People finally learned it was all true, because half an hour to the show, everyone doubted everything. Really everyone. I was dumbstruck. I was paralyzed. A kind of powerful psychic impact I couldn't even imagine. I completely forgot about the rain and my wet feet, that I was hungry, and that everything was all bad. What Michael Jackson had was all the latest in technology, and we didn't even know what it was. There were lasers, then special effects, which had never been seen in Russia before, and amplifiers, quite a lot of them, more than a ton. And we were told to bring even a bio-toilet for Michael Jackson. So there was everything, including a bio-toilet. Michael's team demanded in the rider a golf cart to move around in the arena. At that time, the only golf club in Russia had just opened. We, of course, called them, and we got a negative reply, because there was just one golf cart there, and no one wanted to take the risk of renting it out to us. I hired a technical team of 30 people, but I needed 60, so I called the paratroopers. When we started negotiating, we learned that the paratroopers did not even need to be paid. The paratroopers said they would do it for food and cigarettes. When preparing the show, we had to call up some soldiers to help us out. In 1993, they were eager to do a lot just for food and cigarettes. And we really appreciated it, as they completed quite an amount of heavy manual labor.
It was, in my opinion,
In my understanding, this was the first visit when the characters of our showbiz tried to get an inkling of appropriate behavior. Actually, they didn't have a clue as to what to do, how to welcome people, and this was quite obvious.
I'm the assistant of Mr. Avram and Mr. Jackson, you know.
I hope that the Russian people will enjoy us, and Michael Jackson will perform a very good concert.
I can remember the arrival quite well. The plane taxied up, the gangway was brought up, then another half hour passed. And then he came out, stopped for a few seconds on the gangway, greeting the people, and instantly descended, boarded one of the limousines, and off he went. The way he was welcomed was rather pathetic. No one had an idea who he was and how a star was to be treated. It was like welcoming a party leader from the GDR, some Eric Honecker, with the only difference that there was no Brezhnev waiting there to give him a kiss. Michael Jackson was welcomed like a god. People did not really know how to welcome him, like General Secretary Brezhnev, modestly applauding or waving hands, shouting and dancing around the happy way. So it was the full spectrum, the most natural human reaction and signs of joy. This was the first time ever when in front of the hotel a huge crowd came together. Now I rather think most people wanted tickets for free. They drew posters, rolled them up into tubes, and then unrolled them. But the rain washed off what they wrote, like, "We love you." When fellows from Jackson's team came out with the tickets, people reacted in different ways. Many stretched out their hands and actively begged for tickets. I noticed that fellows from Jackson's team did not respond to exactly this kind of people.
Slowly, slowly, please. Madame. Passive. Two, no, next two. For the mama, papa, and everybody.
Pretty modestly, I stood at the fence. And the guy who spotted me came up and gave me this ticket. I have no idea why it happened this way.
Ты бы иначе мог бы купить билет?
Нет.
Нет, почему?
Тебе нравится Майкл Джексон? А где ты его слышал?
The ticket itself looked quite unusual. We were used to tickets printed on rough paper, designating where, when, and at what time the show was to begin, and a detachable control chit. The ticket for Michael Jackson's show was vertical, on velvet-like paper with imprints, with full colors, and a poster-like picture of Michael. It was quite dense paper. The tickets were very expensive, and you could feel that in your hand.
Скажи, Катя, вот это вот не фальшивые билеты, а то у нас их брать не будет.
I remember that our fans did not show any aggression, and I appreciated this. Everything was very sincere, and until the moment when Jackson's shadow appeared in the window of Hotel Metropole, no one really believed he had arrived. People were not quite sure that Michael Jackson would come to Russia. people felt somewhat in a quandary, understanding that something big and significant was happening, even great. But at that time, people just hung around like gapers, and I happened to be one of them for a while. I stood in the crowd just being curious to see how people reacted to what was going on. And they whispered, oh, he came out at night indeed, and he was handing out autographs.
Hello, Michael.
Hello, Joe.
He's in the perfect place there.
I didn't really see any super fanatism, rather a sincere wonder like, oh, he's come out to us, wow! This amazement was of an innocent nature, absolutely. Some young girls were around, fans of Michael Jackson, who came there purposefully. I'm a Soviet schoolgirl in the 10th year, and I've never before seen the kind of show that was brought to Moscow on September 15th, 1993. The people did not get it. They were of a different wavelength. The feeling was that we are a savage country and do not possess this culture. It was quite a shame. I've seen some Michael Jackson shows before. The way the stands like this, the huge crowds with girls going mad and fainting. Once you've seen it, you don't want to let him down and to be let down yourself. We wanted to show that we were not worse than those fans we've seen on video, and that we also love him, for him not to feel like, where am I? Where are my things? How did I get here? Being a Michael Jackson fan has never been easy. One must be a bit of an E.T. himself. I took two tape recorders, one to play back Michael Jackson, the other an empty tape. I switched on the full volume and sang along and recorded myself with Michael Jackson. Then I went to a friend of mine, she was also a Jackson fan, and we compared the recordings. The two of us recorded interviews with each other, one of us for the journalist and the other for Michael Jackson and vice versa. Some funny moments occurred, of course, based on real interviews we had read. Funny moments like, ha-ha, by the way, I'm a melancholic. So we played the Michael Jackson game. This was our world, and we were kind of Peter Pans. Before renovation, the Olympic Arena had 55,000 seats. The total number of tickets sold was 8,000, maybe 10,000. The cheapest ticket for the dance floor was like 50,000 rubles, at that moment exactly $50, equal to the average monthly salary of an average Moscovite. So to attend Michael Jackson's show with the cheapest ticket, one had to work an entire month. Buying three tickets for Dad, Mom, and me meant to spend Dad's salary. We did it. We bought these tickets, and of course, we were very disappointed as we learned that on the day of the show, tickets were on sale for 6,000 rubles. And finally, they were given away for free. On the day of the show, the tickets did not sell at all. The understanding was that this was going to be rather a flop than a full house. Michael Jackson, the King of Pop, goes on stage and performs in front of an empty stadium. The Luzhniki Arena was more or less full. Only a few seats were occupied. The stands were empty. Most of the crowd was in the front of the stage, half of the football pitch. In any other country, he would collect the full stadium. But here, it looked quite strange. For the help in preparing the concert, quite a number of tickets, maybe 2,500 or 3,000, had been distributed among soldiers. And down in the arena, Michael Jackson likely noticed a lot of hockey uniforms, the color he liked so much. Some say too few people came, but I tell you, it's all a lie. Their arena was full. We stood under the umbrella and had only one hand to applaud. It was cold, plus 7 degrees. We had steamy breath, and everyone had some cognac to warm up. I stood on my tiptoes, shouting and screaming, and I did all I could, as I believed, making my own little contribution. If there had been many people like myself, we could have created the atmosphere we needed. I wanted to help him. When watching this concert, I wanted him to like us, for him to come once again. On that day, our so-called well-wishers, who did not want this concert to happen, launched an airplane with cement to provoke a heavy rainfall. This rain was meant to cancel the show. Some bought tickets for crazy money. Others had been given tickets for free. Just come for God's sake. And others again came out of the subway and turned back, as there was an announcement, concert canceled. Really, announced by the loudspeakers. People said, it's over, return the tickets, and so on. This was the kind of infighting that was there. The press tried to bite, asking whether the show would take place for sure or not, and would it be cancelled indeed, because this was what all the papers had been writing about at the moment. There were more saboteurs than well-wishers, only saboteurs. They did it on purpose, saying that Michael Jackson could not come, that he was sick, that it's only his double, that he has not been traveling anywhere for a long time, dwelling in his hyperbaric chamber, and it's all fraud, a fake, and it's no way any world tour. Nothing is to happen here, and the stage is smaller. It's all an affair, and he's going singing with full playback. Honestly, the entire press had been bought out, and only negative stuff had been published. Nothing good about this concert, not a single article ever. I followed every newspaper article covering this visit, and every news release that mentioned it this or some other way, compared to what we know today about music channels, how they operate, how they manage to penetrate every slit, to take interviews, negotiate with PR agents what's possible and what's not. Of course, I understand that at that time, the information was quite meager. Nobody really knew anything. How to communicate, what to do and what not to do, what is paparazzi, and what could be filmed and what could not be filmed. There was a horrible smear campaign organized by 3 or 4 major producers of the Russian showbiz of that moment, and I was directed to go to one of their offices and to cover it with posters, like wallpaper. Our mafia, gangsters, or, as they say, the sharks of showbiz, as a revenge for sabotage, I sent out my assistants to paste posters to their offices. So they went out by night and pasted posters to their offices, from the bottom and 3-4 meters up, as they mounted on each other's shoulders.
Это все-таки был один из первых
This was one of the first big concerts in Moscow. So our people had no idea of what a number one world star was a priori. A star was coming. Something had to be done. But what exactly, nobody knew. Nobody really understood the methods of manipulating collective consciousness. Комсомольская правда, a highly respected paper at that time, published an article saying that Michael Jackson was not coming. We clearly felt that somebody was behind it, and this was all simply paid for with real money. I bought a newspaper in the metro saying that Michael Jackson was not coming, though I knew for sure that he was to come, as the entire mail exchange was there, all faxes, everything planned, and the point of no return had been passed. This buzz in the media that he's not coming, or coming but not himself, and for sure he would not perform, and it's not him who's coming, all this made him take certain care in making public statements. And he was not really enthusiastic to talk with the press at that moment. One could understand why Michael Jackson did not appear at the press conference. For himself, until the very last minute, the success of his concert in Moscow was doubtful.
Успешности, так сказать, концерта в Москве был под вопросом.
Мы открываем нашу пресс-конференцию, посвященную прибытию в наш город знаменитого Майкла Джексона. Он в данный момент находится по дороге, уже осуществляет свою программу.
If he did not show up at the press conference because he preferred marching with soldiers, it's a clear achievement of his PR advisors. They were not so stupid. They saw how unprepared the press was. I think they used the chance to skip the press conference to avoid getting bad publicity. I was there when Michael Jackson met the soldiers. The impression was completely incredible. This idea matched some of his internal intentions. For me, he was a soldier of goodness. Russian soldiers have always been a kind of scarecrow for the rest of the world. This was a kind of red line ever since the Cold War. But the picture looked a bit like science fiction.
Thank you. Thank you very much.
We were
very happy to see you
today here. Come again.
I'm
happy to see everybody.
Thank you.
Yes, ready.
What I would like to know is what impression Michael Jackson himself had from Russia, as I believe this was one of his most amazing trips in the world. I think if he had written his memoirs now, he would be remembering Moscow with such appreciation.
Michael,
Here it was all the way he wanted it. Nobody obstructed him, and what he wanted was really not that much. He needed to spend much time with himself only. I felt he was rather an introvert. It was clear he was surrounded by a swarm of bloodsuckers, part of whom were working for the sake of themselves and their own glory, but not for the show and not for Jackson. The feeling was rather that he was a deeply lonely and unhappy person. When moving across Moscow, he was accompanied by 20 cars and followed by journalists who exactly knew where he was going and what for. My impression was that he was a hostage to all of this, and what he really wanted was to stay alone and to walk around in Moscow calmly. But the laws of showbiz obliged him to visit this and that, and the Kremlin invited him, and the American embassy as well. He had to follow the preset schedule. He was accessible. Here it was where he was directly accessible. And thank God it ended well in Moscow, because we, the Russian people, have been treating the superstar extremely well, like welcome, добро пожаловать, bread, salt, and so on. What we wanted was to amaze and surprise him with some of our achievements, showing the great and beautiful things that are here in Russia. All possible options were offered, the best from our point of view, just to create a more vivid impression of the country. What I proposed to Michael Jackson was to visit an orphanage for mentally retarded kids. They were all completely lost. They had seen him only on the screen before, and here he was suddenly so accessible, close to them. For the kids, it was a great day.
They've been waiting for you already for 5 hours. Some of them, they even lost their consciousness. That's what I was told.
I've been waiting for him a very long time, dreaming, when watching the player, and thinking, what if I would ever see him? And imagine that picture. One day I would see him. Michael Jackson, and indeed, it came to pass. In 1993, Michael Jackson was 35 years old.
This, they're called the handicapped from
Turco. Oh, there you are.
See?
Every man with 35 years, when holding a child in his arms, should be almost crying, even more considering the fact that this boy is an orphan. He was abandoned. This little boy, not only sick, but he was also abandoned. Michael Jackson looked like a nursing mother.
I'll take you home, I think.
Хороший сын.
Come and say hello.
Michael Jackson went down to Group 7, and there he took a little boy in his arms to cuddle him, and the boy really enjoyed it. Of course, the little child did not understand what was going on, but Michael Jackson was also very happy.
Она не видит.
Да?
Да, она слепая девочка.
I think he felt a lump in his throat, because these kids were the kind that really needed care, and they were hard to cure completely.
Она поест и вырывает. Ротный вызов.
Michael Jackson had a child's soul. This explains his attraction to kids and his understanding of the kids' language. As we can see now, for him the kids' language was understandable better than the language of adults.
Fine, but she hears very well. If the nurse puts the toy here, she will crawl to the toy.
All right.
And it's also her nose. Yeah. It's working very well.
It smells a lot,
Как мы знаем из его биографии.
From his biography, we know that he came into the showbiz at a baby age, and that's why he had no regular childhood. The desire to play was with him until the end of his life, overlaid by the inability of normal communication with people. He was surrounded by fans, both normal people and freaks.
He's making those noises.
It was to read off that he's like a child himself, all because he had nothing in his childhood, no games, no friends. And when grown up, he accomplished everything, clips, concerts, everything he did. And his wish was to play with kids. He liked games. And this is why Jackson is himself like a kid.
All the kids.
Really? I don't know. I'd like to sing with them. If we all know a song together.
Yeah, the other children are waiting for it.
Okay, you ready? We have to move on, I think.
Michael Jackson was a kind of Peter Pan, a little boy that desperately resisted growing up. He had quite a hard time to remain a kid. And that's why I think he had a terribly complicated, schizophrenic, torturous life. We had been warned before he came not to touch him with our hands, but I couldn't help it. When being so close to him, he radiated that kind of aura. I had to do something to make him understand what kind of man he is for me, an angel on earth. So I knelt down close to him and gave him a sheet of paper and a pen, and he signed it for me. He was doing it in no hurry, smoothly, no rush. Meanwhile, I watched him. My heart was beating when I was so close to him. And in my surge of admiration, I kissed his cheek. Can you imagine? I kissed him. The very moment I kissed him, I felt that I had given him a part of myself. I kissed him with such passion, not just pecked him, but like this. Michael Jackson did not expect that Саша Миронов would kiss him. He did not like it, and he ran away. He maybe thought, what kind of a strange person kissed him? What I believe is that Michael Jackson is a great guy. He came and brought presents. I needed nothing more. This is it. After I could not sleep the whole night, I could not realize that Jackson came by. Michael Jackson is a person with clear psychic deviation, a man who at the age of 30, 40, and almost 50, retained the sense of the world, the feeling, and, I'm afraid, the brain of a 12, 13-year-old kid.
Сами его собрали. Вот сувенир будет Майклу.
That would be the souvenir for you.
Yeah.
To remember that.
Thank you.
Your business. Thank you. She wants to go to all the kids. So the only kids can be waiting.
There are opinions it was sexual perversion and that he harassed them, kind of primitive pedophilia. I'm sure in reality it was no way pedophilia. He was just a child himself, and he wanted to play with kids. The situation is indeed tragic. Personally, I don't believe in all these scandals, as too big money was circulated around Jackson, and a great number of people wanted to grab something from him.
The children,
get it
this
berries.
They can make you a present if you want to take it.
Michael Jackson is a very good person. He's a saint. Don't believe he wanted to do something evil. No way. He did only good things for everyone. Regarding being a saint, Strange as it might sound, this is closer to reality than accusations of pedophilia or extraterrestrial origin. In a certain sense, if we consider the essential quality of a saint is innocence, I rather believe he was this kind of an innocent child. By the way, nor do I exclude that he kept his virginity and never had sex in his life, even with his legal wives and close concubines, because he simply did not need it. What the hell does a 10-year-old boy need to have sex for? I think he married just to be left in peace in this respect. On the way to the airport, the convoy suddenly stopped. When Michael stepped out, everybody understood it was his idea to make the stop.
Let me have you right here, and I'll start on you, and then go to the car.
In a minute, it was clear that he just wanted to look at the city, to look around, and maybe say farewell to Moscow, a city which, as we learned after he left, he remembered well and had warm feelings for.
Michael, can you just spin around with your arms out one time? Yes.
Great. I enjoyed what was happening. None of the artists were around. Everything was free and easy. And now I rather understand the spontaneous action of the promoters who organized that concert.
Oh, nice.
Can the church
see
Joe?
Yeah.
So we stood around, looking at St. Basil's Cathedral and the Kremlin. The moment was beautiful, but did not last long. After that, we dashed off to the airport with blinkers and motorcycle cops. Michael Jackson is the king of pop. There is no other king, and maybe there never will be any. The king of pop, who is perfect in both singing and dancing, with the kind of energy that until now I haven't been meeting pop performers like Michael Jackson. A man like him would unlikely be born soon. The music of Michael Jackson has never ever found any demand in Russia. In karaoke, no one is going to order Michael Jackson. But to be more precise, Michael Jackson, and I'll let you in on a secret, is the man from the planet number 241, because the 29th of August is the 241st day of the year. This is it.